Remember your mercies, O Lord, and with your eternal protection sanctify your servants, for whom Christ your Son, by the shedding of his blood, established the paschal mystery, who lives and reigns forever and ever.
Amen.
Beyond human semblance, and his appearance beyond that of the sons of man, so shall he startle many nations. Because of him, kings shall stand speechless, for those who have not been told shall see, those who have not heard shall ponder it. Who would believe what we have heard? To whom has the arm of the Lord been revealed? He grew up like a sapling before him, like a shoot from the parched earth. There was in him no stately bearing to make us look at him, nor appearance that would attract us to him. He was spurned and avoided by people, a man of suffering, accustomed to infirmity, one of those from whom people hide their faces, spurned, and we held him in no esteem. Yet it was our infirmities that he bore, our sufferings that he endured. While we thought of him as stricken, as one smitten by God and afflicted, but he was pierced for our offenses, crushed for our sins. Upon him was the chastisement that makes us whole. By his stripes we were healed. We have all gone astray like sheep, each following his own way, but the Lord laid upon him the guilt of us all. Though he was harshly treated, he submitted and opened not his mouth. Like a lamb led to the slaughter, or a sheep before the shearers, he was silent and opened not his mouth. Oppressed and condemned, he was taken away, and who would have thought any more of his destiny? When he was cut off from the lands of the living and smitten for the sin of his people, a grave was assigned him among the wicked and a burial place with evildoers. Though he had done no wrong, nor spoken in falsehood. But the Lord was pleased to crush him in infirmity. If he gives his life as an offering for sin, he shall see his descendants in a long life, and the will of the Lord shall be accomplished through him. Because of his affliction, he shall see the light in fullness of days. Through his suffering, my servant shall justify many, and their guilt he shall bear. Therefore, I will give him his portion among the great, and he shall divide the spoils with the mighty, because he surrendered himself to death and was counted among the wicked, and he shall take away the sins of many, and win pardon for their offenses. The word of the Lord.
Thank you.
reading from the letter to the Hebrews. Brothers and sisters, since we have a great high priest who has passed through the heavens, Jesus, the Son of God, let us hold fast to our confession. For we do not have a high priest who is unable to sympathize with our weaknesses, but one who has similarly been tested in every way, yet without sin. So let us confidently approach the throne of grace to receive mercy and to find grace for timely help. In the days when Christ was in the flesh, he offered prayers and supplications with loud cries and tears to the one who was able to save him from death, and he was heard because of his reverence. Son though he was, he learned obedience from what he suffered, and when he was made perfect, he became the source of eternal salvation for all who obey him. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
So Judas got a band of soldiers and guards from the chief priests and the Pharisees and went there with the lanterns, torches, and weapons. Jesus, knowing everything that was going to happen to him, went out and said to them,
"Whom are you looking for?"
They answered him,
"Jesus the Nazarene."
He said to them,
"I am."
Judas, his betrayer, was also with them. When he said to them, "I am," they turned away and fell to the ground. So he again asked them,
"Whom are you looking for?"
They answered,
"Jesus the Nazarene."
Jesus answered,
"I told you that I am. So if you are looking for me, let these men go."
This was to fulfill what he had said, "I have not lost any of those you gave me." Then Simon Peter, who had a sword, drew it, struck the high priest's slave, and cut off his right ear. The slave's name was Malchus. Jesus said to Peter,
"Put your sword into its scabbard. Shall I not drink the cup the Father gave me?"
So the band of soldiers, the tribune, and the Jewish guards seized Jesus, bound him, and brought him to Annas first. He was the father-in-law of Caiaphas, who was the high priest that year. It was Caiaphas who had counseled the Jews that it was better that one man should die rather than the people. Simon Peter and another disciple followed Jesus. Now the other disciple was known to the high priest, and he entered the courtyard of the high priest with Jesus. But Peter stood at the gate outside. So the other disciple, the acquaintance of the high priest, went out and spoke for the gatekeeper and brought Peter in. Then the maid, who was the gatekeeper, said to Peter,
"You are not one of the six disciples, are you?"
He said,
"I am not."
Now the slaves and the guards were standing around a charcoal fire that they had made because it was cold, and were warming themselves. Peter was also standing there, keeping warm. The high priest questioned Jesus about his disciples and about his doctrine. Jesus answered him,
"I have spoken publicly to the world. I have always taught in a synagogue or in the temple area where all the Jews gather. And in secret I have said nothing. Why ask me? Ask those who heard me what I said to them. They know what I have said."
When he had said this, one of the temple guards standing there struck Jesus and said,
"Is this the way you answer the high priest?"
Jesus answered him,
"If I have spoken wrongly, testify to the wrong. But if I have spoken rightly, why do you strike me?"
Then Annas sent him bound to Caiaphas, the high priest. Now Simon Peter was standing there keeping warm, and they said to him,
"You are not one of his disciples, are you?"
He denied it and said,
"I am not."
One of the slaves of the high priest, the relative of the one whose ear Peter had cut off, said,
"Didn't I see you in the garden with him?"
Again Peter denied it, and immediately the cock crowed. Then they brought Jesus from Caiaphas to the praetorium. It was morning, and they themselves did not enter the praetorium in order not to be defiled so that they could eat the Passover. So Pilate came out to them and said,
"What charge do you bring against this man?"
They answered and said to him,
"If you were not a criminal, you would not have handed him over to you."
At this, Pilate said to them,
"Take him yourselves and judge him according to your law."
The Jews answered him,
"We do not have the right to execute him anymore."
In order that the word of Jesus might be fulfilled, that he said, indicating the kind of death would die. So Pilate went back into the praetorium and summoned Jesus and said to him,
"Are you the king of the Jews?"
Jesus answered,
"Do you say this on your own, or have others told you about me?"
Pilate answered,
"I am not a Jew, am I? Your own nation and the chief priests handed you over to me. What have you done?"
Jesus answered,
"My kingdom does not belong to this world. If my kingdom did belong to this world, my attendants would be fighting to keep me from being handed over to the Jews. But as it is, my kingdom is not here."
So Pilate said to him,
"Then you are a king."
Jesus answered,
"You say I am a king. For this I was born, and for this I came into the world, to testify to the truth. Everyone who belongs to the truth listens to my voice."
Pilate said to him,
"What is truth?"
When he had said this, he again went out to the Jews and said to them,
"I find no guilt in him, but you have a custom that I release one prisoner to you at Passover. Do you want me to release to you the king of the Jews?"
They cried out again,
"Not this one, but Barabbas."
Now Barabbas was a revolutionary. Then Pilate took Jesus and had him scourged. And the soldiers wove a crown out of thorns and placed it on his head and clothed him in a purple cloak. And they came to him and said,
"Hail, King of the Jews!"
And they struck him repeatedly. Once more, Pilate went out and said to them,
Look, I am bringing him out to you, so that you may know that I find no guilt in him.
So Jesus came out, wearing the crown of thorns and the purple cloth, and Pilate said to them,
Behold the man.
When the chief priests and the guards saw him, they cried out,
Crucify him! Crucify him!
Pilate said to them,
Take him yourselves and crucify him. I find no guilt in him.
The Jews answered,
We have a law, and according to that law, we ought to die, because he made himself the Son of God.
Now when Pilate heard this statement, he became even more afraid, and went back to the praetorium and said to Jesus,
Where are you from?
Jesus did not answer him. So Pilate said to him,
Do you not speak to me? Do you not know that I have power to release you, and I have power to crucify you?
Jesus answered him,
You would have no power over me if it had not been given to you from above. For this reason, the one who handed me over to you has the greater sin.
Consequently, Pilate tried to release him, but the Jews cried out,
If you release him, you are not a friend of Caesar. Everyone who makes himself a king opposes Caesar.
When Pilate heard these words, he brought Jesus out and seated him on the judge's bench in the place called the stone pavement, in Hebrew, Gabbatha. It was preparation day for the Passover, and it was about noon, and he said to the Jews,
Behold your king.
They cried out,
Take him away, crucify him.
Pilate said to them,
Shall I crucify your king?
The chief priests answered,
We have no king but Caesar.
Then he handed him over to them to be crucified. So they took Jesus, and carrying the cross himself, he went out to what is called the place of the skull, in Hebrew, Golgotha, where they crucified him, and with him two others, one on either side, with Jesus in the middle. Pilate also had an inscription written and put on the cross. It read, Jesus the Nazarene, the King of the Jews. Now many of the Jews read this inscription, because the place where Jesus was crucified was near the city. It was written in Hebrew, Latin, and Greek. So the chief priests of the Jews said to Pilate,
Do not write the name of the Jews, but that he said, I am the King of the Jews.
Pilate answered,
What I have written, I have written.
When the soldiers had crucified Jesus, they took his clothes and divided them into four shares, a share for each soldier. They also took his tunic, but the tunic was seamless, woven in one piece from the top down. So they said to one another,
Let's not tear it, but cast lots for it, see whose it will be.
In order that the passage of Scripture might be fulfilled that says, They divided my garments among them, and for my vesture they cast lots. This is what the soldiers did. Standing by the cross of Jesus were his mother and his mother's sister, Mary, the wife of Clopas, and Mary of Magdala. When Jesus saw his mother and the disciple there whom he loved, he said to his mother,
Woman, behold your son.
Then he said to the disciple,
Behold your mother.
And from that hour, the disciple took her into his home. After this, aware that everything was now finished, in order that Scripture might be fulfilled, Jesus said,
I thirst.
There was a vessel filled with common wine. So they put a sponge soaked in wine on a spring of hyssop, in a sprig of hyssop, and put it up his mouth. When Jesus had taken the wine, he said,
It is finished.
And bowing his head, he handed over the Spirit. Resurrection Day, in order that the bodies might not remain on the cross on the Sabbath, for the Sabbath day of that week was a solemn one. The Jews asked Pilate that their legs be broken and that they might be taken down. So the soldiers came and broke the legs of the first and then of the other one who was crucified with Jesus. But when they came to Jesus and saw that he was already dead, they did not break his legs. But one soldier thrust his lance into his side, and immediately blood and water flowed out. An eyewitness has testified, and his testimony is true. He knows that he's speaking the truth, so that you also may come to believe. For this happened so that the scripture passage might be fulfilled. Not a bone of it will be broken. And again, another passage says, they will look upon him whom they have pierced. After this, Joseph of Arimathea, secretly a disciple of Jesus for fear of the Jews, asked Pilate if he could remove the body of Jesus, and Pilate permitted it. So he came and took his body. Nicodemus, the one who had first come to him at night, also came bringing a mixture of myrrh and aloes, weighing about 100 pounds. They took the body of Jesus and bound it with burial cloths along with the spices, according to the Jewish burial custom. Now in the place where he had been crucified, there was a garden, and in the garden a new tomb, in which no one had yet been buried. So they laid Jesus there because of the Jewish preparation day, for the tomb was close by. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Yesterday we celebrated the day of Christ's priesthood, where at the Last Supper he gave us the Holy Eucharist, and to share in his priesthood to men, to be his sacred ministers, and to perpetuate the sacrifice of the Eucharist for us all. And yet, there's a divine irony. This very next day, there is no sacrifice offered by any of his priests. This is not a mass. It is as if the church and the priests from the earliest days, out of reverence and deference to our Lord's sacrifice on the cross, remained silent and recalled that Christ himself offered the sacrifice on the cross. That sacrifice from which even his offering at the Last Supper gets all of its meaning. I don't have time to go through the immense suffering that our Lord has endured. And if I did, it's almost so much that we can't relate. So I'm going to give a couple revelations that were given to St. Bridget, given to her by the Blessed Virgin Mary. One, that during his passion, he endured 5,475 wounds. The first reading is not an exaggeration. He was a living, walking wound. And then, St. Bridget describes the bitterness of this one element of his passion, which may seem very minor otherwise. That is Christ's crown. Our Blessed Mother told St. Bridget, they contrived a crown of thorns for his head, which pricked the venerable head of my son so severe that the blood which flowed filled his eyes and obstructed his ears. And his beard was completely fouled with the blood running down. Elsewhere, the Blessed Virgin Mary recounted to St. Bridget. The crown of thorns embraced his head most tightly and came down as low as the middle of the forehead. So many streams of blood rushing down from the sharp points over his face and filling his hair and eyes and beard. He seemed to be nothing but one mass of blood. Nor could he see me standing by the cross, unless he squeezed out the blood by compressing his eyes. Our Lord endured this, and he did endure it willingly. He shows us the severity of our sin, but actually the greatest reason he endured this and has revealed this to us is to show the great lengths of the love that he goes through for your salvation and mine. So let us hold both firmly to realize that we should not downplay our own sin. And let us, with that confidence in the immense love of our Lord, that he took the cross for us, the crown of thorns and scourging, let us approach him with confidence and hope. This is Good Friday. As one of the school kids asked me, why do we call it Good Friday if Jesus died? Well, that's why. Atonement for our sins. Redemption of our souls for eternal life. He seemed to be nothing but one mass of blood. And there beneath the cross stood his mother. It might seem a strange thing that the very woman who endured all of this loves us more than any other human being save her divine son. Oh, Mary, was it a comfort to you to hold your son's body when taken down from the cross? By your fiat, your yes, you gave us the Son of God made man. And by our sins, we give his lifeless, disfigured body back to you. What can we possibly do to console you? Though your son's body is yet another sorrow for you, you cling to it as all that you have left. But even this consolation must end. Joseph of Arimathea is coming to place your son's body in his tomb. The preparation for burial with Nicodemus is all too brief. Then the last sword of sorrow pierces your heart, the stone sealing your son's tomb. The finality sets in that your son is dead. But there on the hill of gold remains your son's cross. It is all she has left now. Going to it, Mary looks upon the bloody altar, the cross, and adores this instrument made holy by Christ's precious blood. By it, all sins are forgiven, and Mary herself preserved from all sin. She reverences it with a kiss. Dear children, let us with St. John, the beloved disciple, given to her by Christ on the cross. Let us go with her, adore her son's most holy cross, and console our mother's sorrows. Beseeching our Lord's mercy on this day of the sacrifice of Christ on the cross, we now turn to him. Please stand.
Let us pray the
light revealed her glory to all the nations. Watch over the works of your mercy, that your church spread throughout all the world. May persevere with steadfast faith and confessing your name. Through Christ our Lord. Let us stand. Almighty ever-living God, by whose decree all things are founded, look with favor on our prayers, and in your kindness protect the Pope chosen for us, that under him the Christian people governed by you their Maker may grow in merit by reason of their faith. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Almighty ever-living God, by whose Spirit the whole body of the Church is sanctified and governed, hear our humble prayer for your ministers, that by the gift of your grace all may serve you faithfully. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen. Let us stand.
Almighty, ever-living God, make your church ever fruitful with new offspring. Increase the faith and understanding of catechumens, that reborn in the font of baptism, they may be added to the number
to gather them together and keep them in his one charge. Let us kneel. Let us stand.
Almighty, ever-living God, gather what is scattered and keep together what you have gathered. Look kindly on the flock of your Son, that those whom one baptism has consecrated may be joined together by integrity of faith and united in the bond of charity. Through Christ our Lord.
Let us stand.
Almighty, ever-living God, who bestowed your promises on Abraham and his descendants, graciously hear the prayers of your church, that the people you first made your own may attain the fullness of redemption. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen. Amen. Amen.
Let us pray also for those who do not believe in Christ, that enlightened by the Holy Spirit, they too may enter on the way of salvation. Let us kneel. Let us stand.
Almighty, ever-living God, grant those who do not confess Christ, that by walking before you with a sincere heart, they may find the truth. And that we ourselves, being constant in mutual love, and striving to understand more fully the mystery of your blood, may be made more perfect witnesses to your love in the world. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
pastime.
Almighty ever living God, who created all people to seek you always by desiring you, and by finding you come to invest, grant, we pray, that despite every harmful obstacle, we may recognize the signs of your fatherly love and the witness of your good works done by those who believe in you, and so in gladness confess you, the one true God and Father of our human race, through Christ our Lord.
Amen. Let us stand.
Almighty, ever-living God, comfort of mourners, strength of all who toil, may the prayers of those who cry out in any tribulation come before you, that all may rejoice because in their hour of need your mercy was at hand, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Thank you.
Behold the wood of the cross, on which hung the salvation of the world.
Come and hear us, my
Behold the wood of the cross, on which hung the salvation of the world.
Come.
Let us pray. Almighty ever living God, who have restored us to life by the blessed death and resurrection of your Christ, preserve in us the work of your mercy, that by partaking of this mystery, we may have a life unceasingly devoted to you. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Bow down for the blessing.
May abundant blessing, O Lord, we pray, descend upon your people who have honored the death of your Son in the hope of the resurrection. May pardon come, comfort be given, holy faith increase, and everlasting redemption be made secure. Through Christ our